Hi everybody, I wanted to start off this movie showing you the results of the crystal cell that we made, and you can see that it formed a crystal, and pretty soon I can remove this and put it in something. But it's been standing here, and I'm a one-armed cameraman, so you'll have to forgive me. But let me actually get a clip lead for this. So you can see here. And I'm just going to hook it up to the oscillator. And you can watch here. So now this has become a rechargeable cell running the oscillator. And so what we'll get into is the Alum batteries a little bit more, and the solar switch, and what you can do with a 10 amp tracker, the 20 amp tracker, or an 80 amp tracker running lights at night. So I'm going to show you that switch, and I'll be back. But I just wanted you to see here that what it's done here. I'm going to take it out of the Alum, and you can see the colors on the plates, and that's the way it should look. You can see the center one is rust red, and the outsides are charcoal gray. So there's a better example of it right there. So I'll be back. Okay, sometime back, we took this 1951 Korean War battery and converted it to Alum. There's never been any acid in here. And you can see the balls don't flow right, and the standing voltage usually is around 1180. Okay, so what I want to show you is that what's going to drive the solar tracker here, because it doesn't make any difference what panel you put on this. So we're going to go out of here. Make a difference too. So these are, this is an Alum battery, and this is an Alum battery, and then we'll be working with a solar switch after this. Anyway, I'm going to turn the tracker on, and you can see here what it's going to do. So I want to make sure we get this hooked up right. But I'll be back in a minute here. Anyway, we got the tracker hooked up, and I'm sorry I had the meter on hold, but you can see how it's charging this Alum battery, and that's this one here. And that's a 24 amp hour battery, so that's going to give us some real current. And you can watch the chart here, how Alum charges. It's not good to put the meter in hold and then try to show you something, so I'm sorry about that. But anyway, you can see that it's going to charge up on this curve and then flatten out. So I'll be back as soon as it raises a little bit more. And don't worry about using any one of these trackers. It can be this or the 20 amp or the 40 amp or the 50 amp. Because when it gets to the battery to the point to where it's charged, it will start to desulfate, and this will go green, and this will dim way down, which means it's in the oscillating mode. So I'll be back. Now I've disconnected the 10 amp charger and I put an 80 amp solar tracker in here. But remember, it's only running off that little panel, so you can see right away that it's going to go up here and match this curve as this goes up. All right, so this is a sun tracking system. And, you know, I might mention to a friend on the groups, Les, K. It doesn't make any difference, Les, because once it reaches the level it needs to, this is going to go green, and it's not going to burn your battery up. So I'm using an 80 amp here with a 1 amp panel, basically. And so we'll just watch it now. For those of you that are not familiar with this tracker, this machine senses the sun and then applies a bandwidth filter that's equivalent to the panel, where the panel sees the light. So I want to make sure you all understand that this is running in a bell curve. So for the simple reason is that the solar panels work in the far infrared range, and so you don't care about anything beyond that. So below it or above it, you just want it in that curve, and that way you're getting the maximum power from the panel to the battery. And you can see here that it's just going to put it to it until it reaches its 15 volt level. Now this is a big battery, so this is going to take some time with a 1 amp panel. But I want you to see the curve of how it's doing this. So what's happening is this is raising up, and the tracker is starting to track the charge curve. So I don't know how high I can push it within a 1 amp panel, but we're going to find out, and I'll be back. Okay, anyway, the nice thing about this battery is you can see into it, so you can see it bubbling here. And the 1 amp panel, with, I don't think is going to push it beyond 1432, which is okay. That's fine, as long as it applies the power to the battery. And this is why I'm saying that if you convert one, you want to probably use a 900 coal cranking amp battery if you want to run all kinds of solar lights. And you don't have to worry about this going to zero, because it'll come right back, and I'll show you that. Anyway, you can see it's continuing to climb up on its charge curve. And now let me switch auto scale so you can see how it's doing it. But anyway, right here is where I changed chargers, so I need to make no mistake about that. Okay, so it's at 1432, approaching it, and we're just going to let it go, and then we'll come back and with different things that we're going to do here in this video. All right, I'm back, and we can see that it's pushing it up. And you can see the charge curve here. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to add the solar switch to the tracker to run the lights at night. Not that you'd even be using this tracker for this, because this has a built-in, the solar switch has a built-in diode to do this. And so I'm going to hook it up and show you. I'll be back. Okay, now we have this solar switch hooked up. This is where I've disconnected the battery, this little gap right here, and then connected the solar switch. And as you can see, the solar switch for charging the Alum battery pushes the battery pretty good, because it's directly to the panel and then it's regulated. So what happens is when the sun goes down. They're me disconnecting the solar panel. You can see what's going to happen here. The lights come on. And that's what you get. And then, of course, when the sun comes back up, that's the lights go out and the battery continues to charge, as you can see right here. So now it's going to push it back up again. So a full day of sun and you've got a pretty good charged Alum battery, especially if you have a big one like this. You can run a lot of things with this, considering it's a 24 amp hour battery and it was formed with Alum. So now I'll sort of get into some other things you can do with and we'll go ahead and do the battery that we made yesterday also, so you can see that charge. I'll be back. Okay, I'm back, and this is the battery that we made yesterday, and I posted the video on. It's a little 5 amp hour battery. It's connected to the solar switch. It's got the battery pushed up here, which is abusive, which is just fine for this kind of battery, because you're going to see here in a second that I'm going to take the sun away and what's going to happen here. So that's what I'm going to do now. And of course your light comes on, and we're going to let that run down to its plateau. And you can see that's right here. So at 10.5 volts, on an Alum battery, you're at exactly 1.75 volts. Remember what I was looking for, 1.2 per cell. Okay? Just like a NiCad. And so we're sitting here and it's starting to come down on its plateau right now. You can see it. And of course, if I add the sun back, which I'll do real quick here, then you can see that it starts immediately charging the battery again. And an Alum battery charges pretty quick here, you can see. Alright, so if Chuck goes outside and flips the panel to dark, in other words, turns it over. Now I want you to see this, because there's still light leaking through it, Chuck, through the backside. Probably have to bring it in here, bring it into the dark. Nope, still leaking through. So we're talking about nighttime here. Okay, good. Now see where Chuck's put it, and see the lights came on. Okay, now go put it back out in the sun. As soon as it detects the charge, the light goes out. And continues to charge the battery. And it does it pretty quick. So, I'll disconnect the sun and we'll do a little discharge curve here. But if you're interested in this switch, I won't be posting any diagrams on this switch, because it's something that we developed here, and you can get them from us. The lights you can buy from off the internet, the battery you can buy at your local auto parts store. So anyway, I'll be back with a discharge curve, and you can see that the curve is showing you. So we're going to discharge this and then let the sun charge it, so you can see that. Be back. Okay, we are continuing to load this battery. And what did you say, Chuck, when it hits about what?
7.2.
About 7.2 volts here, it should hit its curve and run just like a NiCad battery. And that's all I was looking for anyway, because remember, the alum battery is totally different than the lead acid battery, even though we're using the lead and the lead oxides to do this. But that's good, because this gives us current. And you can see here that this is starting to slow down a little bit, so it's going to find a plateau here, and it's going to run out. And the nice thing about this type of situation is that you have a lot of extra energy. Like a 12-volt battery, lead-acid battery, might sit at 12.67, but at 12 volts, it's dead. So you've used all that. This is quite different. So I'm about 1.7 volts now, and I've got to go down to 1.2 and then go down from there. So you can see that it's going to keep running this probably all the way down. But you can make LED lighting panels instead of something like this that will run at those voltages for a real long time, especially at night. And then, of course, it's a quick charge. You know, the minute the solar panel sees the sun, this is going to be a very quick charge. And you can try charging it other ways, but the solar is probably the panel. Even in low light on a cloudy day, we'll charge this. And so you can see that it's continuing to climb down, and it's going to find out, it's going to find its curve. And I'll be back in a little bit. Okay, we've been on for a while now, and we're still continuing to maintain about 1.6 volts per cell. So we're not going down very fast. You know, I'm looking for the 1.2 volt range. So remember, we're just pulling the charge off the top of this now until the cell can plateau. And so I'll continue doing this, and then I'll come back, because I don't want any mistakes on this at all. And then I'll show you how it charges and what can be done. I'll be back. Okay, I'm back. And it's been quite a little bit of time here on this curve. And you can see we're at the same rate as approximately a 1.5 volt, you know, battery for a flashlight. And remember, I'm looking for 1.2 in that curve. So you can see the light's still going nice and bright. And of course, you can make this light. Anyway, I got cut off because of memory, so I was here showing you that I'm at 9.44 volts. And what I want to do is show you this exact curve so you can see how it follows the curve, and then I'll show you the charging curve. I want to make no mistakes with this. I'm going to point out to you everything that we're doing, like these little modules and things like this that we make available, goes to support the board. So we hope you are having a lot of enjoyment out of this, because we're trying to explain to you how you can do this on your own. You know, don't just take my word for it. Do the experiments yourself. But where we're sitting is 9.4342, right in that range. So if you just take that and divide it by 6 cells, you're 1.5 volts, which is about the same thing as a AA battery or a D battery. And you have current with this. So I'll get into that in a little bit, and I'll show you how this Alum battery, when they get bigger than this 5 amp hour one, how they can drive a lot of things that are 12 volts that you need to do. So they could run oscillators, they could run computer boards, they could run switching boards, they can drive your garden lights outside like this. And with no problem at all. So I'll be back when I reach the 1.2 volt level. Oh, one other thing I might point out here is we're starting to reach a point where this curve is going to start to flatten out and run for a long time. And so we're at 9.40 volts. And we'll drop down to that one level. But these indications right here, what it's telling me and what I'm looking at is the impedance of the cell. See, it's not a lead acid battery, it's an alum battery. So the impedance is totally different in the cell. Remember, it does not stand like a lead acid battery. It stands more like a D battery or a NiCad battery. And so that's what's very important to understand, this impedance right here. This is what the potential is pushed up to during charging. And then, of course, the battery is going to fall to a level and stay there. And then as you draw the load, it's going to follow a curve out and down, just like a NiCad. And that's what's so intriguing about this, is there's no lead acid involved at all, just using the lead plates and the oxides in the battery. And as you can see, it can drive these lights without any problem, even at a lower voltage. But you can make a light that's far brighter than this at these voltage levels. But this was quick and handy to show you, experimental-wise, what's going on here. So I'll be back. I'm still looking for that 1.2 volt level. So what we got here so far is we're about in the same range as this D-cell battery. And something that I'm going to explain to you, when the two impedances equal each other, this impedance and the switch, then this will flatline like it's doing now. So it's pretty close. So we took that 9.24 and divided that by 6 cells. We're at 1.54 volts. And we're starting to hold a flat curve. So the impedances are getting very close here between what the LED light's doing and the switch. And it's going to plateau here somewhere where it's just going to stay. And this is doing a lot better than what I calculated for the impedance of this cell, because the impedance is totally a high resistance cell compared to a lead acid battery. And even if these can give you current for a long time, they can't. You can't do anything with them. You throw them out when they're done. A NiCad's the only one that you can recharge, or a nickel metal hydrate. So you're going to run along the same curves with quite a difference in impedance here. So I'm looking for 7.2 volts. And then I'll be in the range of the NiCad. And that's when I want to take and keep the load on it and then watch the end of the curve. So I'll be back. Okay, now this panel that we made takes 2.1 amps from the cell to drive all these LEDs with the resistor bridge. And this is going to take me all day to do this, so I'm going to put the load to the battery and we're going to run the curve out. It's going to make it much easier so you can see what happens here and that the switch can handle it. And I'll be right back. All right, now you can see that we're really pulling the load now, and that's pretty bright, and that the switch can handle that with no problem at all. And look at where the alum battery is with this load. So I'm hoping this will pull it down faster. It doesn't look like it. It looks like it can supply some real current to it, even with a high impedance between the plates. This is very important for you to know, that when these two impedances equal, then you'll get the flat line. But you can see that's pretty darn bright. And a lot of them. So I'm really trying to pull this battery down as quickly as I can so I can show you the curve. And it looks like it's going to take me a while, so I'll be back as it starts to move downward. Okay, now I've doubled these lights. And I'm going for 2.5 amps, 3 amps. And you can see I'm looking for the 7-volt range, so we can watch it here, what it's doing to this. So to do this, and it's pretty hot, you need some current to do this. This is a super bright panel, and this is just a little bit lower in intensity. It was an experiment that I was doing for lighting panels for Alum batteries. And the switch, of course, is cool. And we're just going to watch this. So I'm trying to get to 7.2 here, and it's really taking a lot of time to do this. So I'll be back. So it looks like we're going to sit in this range for a long time before we get to 1.2. You can see the curve. It's getting close to balancing the impedances with all these lights. And that's from this battery again that we put the video on yesterday. And so I'm actually pretty happy with the way these Alum batteries work, especially with the impedance that they have, which is nowhere near the lead acid. And of course we're sitting at 8.82, and so we're sitting at the 1.4 volt range. I'm looking for 1.2. And so in a little bit I think I'll have my 1.2, and then I'm just going to run it out. And then I'm going to recharge it for you, so you can see it come up on the curve and how quickly the Alum battery will charge because of the impedance. The closer you can get to the solar cell impedance, the faster the charge will be. So I'll be back. Okay, I'm back. There's another thing I'm going to point out here. We've taken about 3 amp hours out of this 5 amp hour battery so far. So, and that's pretty good out of a cell like this, out of just a cheap, inexpensive motorcycle battery. And just required forming, you know, on the solar charger. And once again, this is going to take us a long time because this can supply current to get this down to the 1.2 volt level. We're nowhere near it yet. And it's been about 2.5 hours. And I'll be back as soon as this drops down, if it drops down. I could be here all day. But while I'm here right now, I want to thank everybody for that donated to this board. It really helps us support the board and do all this stuff. And thank you all again for the help. And I'll be back. Alright, so now our impedance is equaled what the cell's impedance is, because we're holding at this voltage, and you can see a little rise right here. And so 8.76 divided by 6 cells is 1.46 volts per cell on this Alum battery. And so what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to even put a more extreme load on it, which is going to be a 65 watt car light, and I'll be back to show you that. Okay, now I'm masking it for a lot of current here at 65 watts. And you can see I've got it to the level that I want. And now I'm just going to run it out on this curve and see what it does. I had a little disconnection right here, but you can see now the curve has moved down here. Remember what I said. I was looking for current in these kind of cells. And that takes an impedance. So, some of the questions were, could you run an SG machine on this? The answer is yes. And the charging would take place pretty quick. So, I'm actually asking for a lot out of this little 5 amp hour battery, and so I'm going to get my 5 amp hours no matter what here. So you can see it's going down pretty good now. And then I'll show you the Korean War battery run this light, and we'll do I'll add it to the curve over here. So you can see we've dropped down to this level. We're down at 5 volts. And it's continuing to drop downward if my clip leads and stay on. Nothing like crappy clip leads. And so we'll just let it run out. I'll be back. Okay, I'm dying pretty quick here. I'm down to 3 volts, see 3.7. And you can see that it's a steep curve, so it's abusive to this 5 amp hour battery. Now I've got my 5 amp hours out of it, and it's continuing to run. And I don't know, I might about 4.98 amp hours. So that's pretty good on this cell. Now we'll let it recover. And you can see it recover. And of course, that indication is, here's your recovery right here. So I'll give it a few minutes and I'll be back. Alright, you can get a pretty good indication of the recovery of this cell. It's now at 1.2 volts. Anyway, I'm going to hook the charger back up. And we'll go from there. So here we go. Sorry, I'm a one-handed cameraman. Here we go. Let me make sure I got this. That's minus. That's minus. This is minus. Right. So I'm going to make sure we get this hooked right. So this is minus.
Hooked onto the positive LED.
Okay. I just want to make sure we do this right, so we'll be right back to show you this.
Sorry.
Okay, so we got it hooked up right to the panel, and we're using the switch once again to do it. And so you can watch this. As this, it's a little bit less than 1 amp coming in. I'll put a meter on it so we can read it, so you can see it. And I think I'll do that right now so you can see the current. And just give me a second here and I'll be right back. Okay, you can see that it's coming up. We're going to take it because we took a lot of amp hours out of this battery. And you can see that we're pushing about 1.2 amperes to it from this little solar panel, which is no problem at all for this, because it's only a 5 amp hour battery. So you can see here that we're starting to climb up, and it's starting to move up pretty quick here. And pretty soon we'll be in the 12 volt range. We have to put everything back that we took out, and we need a time on that. So this is our discharge time, and we want to see what the charge time is. I'll be back. Okay, another thing on this cell that I want to point out is we've got a pretty steep charge curve. Now normally, a lead acid battery, when it's dead, will shoot up and come down and then raise on the curve like that. So you can see there's quite an impedance difference in this cell. And you can see it continues to just go up sort of on a linear curve. Okay, I'm sorry I ran out of memory again, so I want you to see where this has gone now with this little 1 amp panel. See the curve? It's linear, almost straight up. And then it's going to reach some level and round off. Okay, so we're at 14.72 and continuing to climb really quick here. And the panel is putting out 1.1 amperes. So as that climbs up, this is going to come down. And you can see that the Alum battery charges on a completely different curve than the lead acid batteries, or even the NiCad battery. So it's like a cross. Okay, so we're at 1502 right now. And we're going to let it find its curve and flatten out. And then we're going to load it with the LEDs again. So definitely it charges pretty quick. So the panel's going to push that to a limit over that. And then I'm going to come back and I'm going to load this battery for you with a car light, just to show you that the current's there. I hope this helps explain how these cells basically work. So, as you can see, it's going up there. I'll be back. Okay. You can see that we have a linear curve on charge, and now it's just starting to round over. That's the limit of the chemical. Right there. And that's all. If you let this go on, it will just build amp hours. And the thing about this is I wanted to see how quickly this is 5, 10, 15, 16 minutes at 1.2 amps. And now if you go and look at the amp meter, you're at about 6/10 of an amp and holding. Which means that these two impedances are equaling between the panel and the Alum cell. And you can see that it's curving over. And it's doing exactly as predicted. So it's following exactly what Alum should do. So I'll let it go a few more minutes and come back. Okay. So now it's been about almost 20 minutes here. So we've charged this battery from dead here in 20 minutes up to its curve. And then if you let this curve just continue out, what will happen is all you're doing now is you're just building amp hour. So to check that real quick, what I'll do to see that it does have the current, is I will disconnect the solar panel and let it fall down. And then I will connect up the car light again to make sure that it has current. And there you go. That's how quickly your Alum battery charged. So, by the way, I've been at this since 8 o'clock this morning doing this. And once again, I want to thank you guys, the ones that have donated to the forum and bought books and stuff like that off the internet sites. As the admin, myself and Chuck, I want to thank you all very much for the support on this. And we're kind of really happy that we can bring you, you know, do this work for you. And I'll come right back and I'm going to load the big Alum battery on the headlight so you can see that. Okay. So I've disconnected our little 5 amp hour cell. And this is the big Alum battery. And then we're going to load that with this so you can see. And we're going to watch this a little bit here and watch what the curve is on that. It says, remember, it's going to want to find some spot here. Since you don't get 12 volts out of it, it's going to want to find some spot where it's going to work in that range. But being that there's so many plates in here, and it was formed with the Alum, it's going to, you know, give you quite a few amp hours out of this battery. That's why I'm suggesting to you that you do something like this car battery here, or a garden battery, because you want the surface area of the plates. So you can see what it is here, where the curve's going to end up. And we'll let it go and I'll come back. Okay, we're on a pretty flat curve, and you can see that this has all the current necessary that you need to do your experiments and everything, and you don't have to worry about sulfuric acid. Anyway, once again, I'm happy that I could do this for you guys so you understand a little bit more about these Alum batteries. And once again, thanks for your support and your donations on the forum, and thank you for buying the books that are listed on the side, as all that goes to support the forum. So thank you once again. And I'll see you all later.